Now, I do appreciate that we've run over, folks, so I will keep it, I will go through briskly. Mine's going to be slightly different, I guess, because I work in the private sector in Dubai, and have done across the Gulf for the last 10 or 11 years, having, like Andy, been in the business since the 1980s. So I'm not going to describe the state, the government side of education in Dubai, because actually more than half the students and more than half the schools are actually within the private sector in Dubai. It is a system that, to a large extent, has handed over a lot of the responsibility for education to the private sector. And like the UK, we are subject to a rigorous Ofsted-like inspection regime. That tends to follow, as the UK updates, Dubai and the UAE tend to update their inspection framework in line with it. At the moment, schools have to endure annual Ofsted-like inspections. So they are always in that process of either preparing for or being inspected. So I'm the director of education for Praxis. Praxis own a fairly new school in Dubai called the Arbor School. It's an ecologically, environmentally focused school based on the National Curriculum for England. And they also own the Australian College University in Kuwait and various other interests. So, sorry, let me just... So there are 208 private schools, just a quick summary there, 363,000 odd seats in the country. The most popular curriculum is UK by far, followed by Indian. All the major curricula are here. But as I say, the UK is the most popular. The average fee in dollars is around $7,500, but fee range in Dubai, because it's such an international place, fee ranges go from $600 to $700 a year, right up to nearly $40,000 a year for schooling, depending on what you want. Students from 173 nationalities in my own school, the Arbor School, there are 50 plus nationalities. You can see there on the left, a typical Dubai student does go to a UK curriculum school. And interestingly, in inspection outcomes, 75% of the schools that are rated as outstanding in Dubai are actually British curriculum. So we have a very, very diverse student body. Students, in terms of students by curriculum, by far the curriculum that is growing and has grown very, very steadily over the last 5 years is the UK British curriculum. Others have flattened out. Teachers in primary and generally, vast majority female, and the top 10 nationalities there. Lots of Indian teachers, because some of the Indian schools are very large. I once was partially responsible for a 10,000 student school in Dubai, Indian curriculum school. But you can see the spread there, a lot of UK-based teachers. The UAE, as part of its vision for education, is really targeting things like PISA scores, and these have been increasing steadily year on year. Dubai, as an education system, still comes fairly down the table, but is going up it with all sorts of initiatives. The Rahal program, referred to at the bottom, is a program where students are schooled partially in school. They access a number, depending on needs or gifts or talents, they access other programs outside of school. It may be that they are going to a professional stables to learn to be a jockey, as well as engaging in school. So there are a number of students that have this sort of mixed economy in their education. I won't go through teacher requirements. It's very similar to elsewhere. Degrees, IELTS scores for English, mandatory professional development required. There's a new teacher licensing program in place in transition, where teachers have to, apart from meeting the qualifications, have to show that they've gone through a process and received certain types of professional development to prepare them. I thought it'd be interesting just to, for people just to hear a bit about our school, because although we are English National Curriculum, we have got this environmental ecological flavour. One of the beauties of a system like Dubai is you have to write obviously an application to get approved as a school, and you have to choose a recognised curriculum. But the flavour that you give it is in your hands and the way that you deliver it. So our school is actually, one of the main owners is a young ecologist who did his PhD in climate change in Cambridge in the UK, and he had this vision for a school, an international school that was focused on environmental sort of education and eco sort of literacy. So the three pillars that we try to inculcate in our students, along with the national curriculum for England, are systems thinking, getting children to understand that the world is made up of environmental systems, financial, political, social, and these systems all interact. And when one part of one system goes out of whack, then it has a knock-on effect to that system, but also other systems. And when we start teaching children about systems thinking, the sort of natural progression into that is thinking about sustainability, and if things are out of kilter, how do we get them back into some sort of healthy balance? And once children have got that notion of systems thinking, then we are really teaching them, you know, elements of eco-literacy and their understanding of our influence, of the way that the different systems impact on each other. When they get to understand and they are more ecologically literate, then it naturally progresses to thoughts around environmental justice. And environmental justice is essentially, you know, why are there some people that have the biggest burden of environmental problems and issues, and others have more of the benefits? And so that's sort of what underpins what we're doing at the Arbor School, and what we plan to do in future Arbor Schools. We're opening another two in Abu Dhabi, and then we aim to open some in some key cities in Europe, the Americas, and possibly further east. What really, from a pedagogical point of view, underpins what we're trying to do as well, is focusing in on project-based learning, and really that is about, and some of our previous speakers have spoken about things like giving students more responsibility. Our Indian colleague mentioned that. From Nigeria, there was some talk about teaching and learning being much more creative and students being more independent. And so we are using a combination of project-based learning, meaningful projects that start with what we call our big questions. We hand those over to students. You can see in one of the photographs where it says specialist facilities, we have a sort of a industrial quality greenhouse set up, and the children produce, plant, nurture, harvest, and produce our own food for use in our own kitchens and canteens. And so, you know, one of those big questions may be something like, you know, how are we going to supply our kitchen with an adequate supply of healthy organic food? How are we going to do that? And that pulls in all sorts of questions then about how much of what do we plant and grow, and how often, and when do we need to plant, and which plants do we plant next to others because there are benefits of mixed cropping. All of those questions come up. So our specialist facilities are also focused on project-based learning and specialist facilities. What we've tried to do is bring a tropical climate in some tropical biodomes into a very arid, hot, dry climate, so that students have experience of an ecosystem that they wouldn't necessarily experience. We have a dome that is the natural tropical environment. We have a dome that is cultivated tropical, bananas, pineapples, mangoes. And then we have a dome, and you can see the children in this picture with project-based learning. They're in the dome that's all about technology. And it's the way that we give them projects where they can use technology to solve real problems. How do we create something to produce wind power and electricity to create light for our domes? So it's that interaction of technology and specialist facilities. We also focus on place-based learning. These are a couple of our students in a local mangrove. So part of what we're also trying to do is situate the national curriculum within the environment that the students are actually within, in the Gulf, and actually try to work out how can we teach them about ecological systems using what is on our doorstep and around us in the UAE, whether that's built environment or natural environment. And so, you know, one of the projects that we're engaged with the Emirates Marine Environmental Group is cultivating, propagating, and then replanting mangrove seeds. And working with them as a charitable organisation to try to repair some of the lost mangrove because of various developments along the coast of the Emirates. So project-based, place-based, so that it becomes a real hands-on, contextualised, real learning experience as far as possible. We're also really, really focusing in on student-led inquiry. From the work that I've done in the past, and some of it with Andy in the UK, looking at how we give children more responsibility for their learning and their thinking, a lot of what I've seen is really teacher-led inquiry, not student-led inquiry. And it's trying to design activities that fall out of the national curriculum, if possible, that give students much more ownership and responsibility. And here are some more pictures of some of our specialist facilities, outdoor spaces to cultivate, indoor spaces to engage in creative problem-solving activities, spaces just to take lessons outside as far as possible when the weather allows. The three bridges that I refer to at the top of this slide is that business of how do we reconcile? I'm just trying to get rid of a menu. How do we reconcile the need to deliver some curriculum, some curriculum standards, and for us it's the English National Curriculum, and the desire to personalise and aim our teaching at various groups of students, from high attaining, low attaining, average attaining, and how do we personalise that to those groups and those individuals, and then how do we move to the another bridge, which is inquiry-based and student-led learning. And we haven't cracked this yet, and I don't think anyone really has around the world. We are working on that, the balance between the three, because the curriculum standards delivery, to a large extent, is about the direct instruction that everyone, and some of our presenters have spoken about it in terms of it not being as good for students as inquiry-led. But actually, the research would suggest that direct instruction to deliver curriculum standards against certain age groups is the most effective way of doing things like getting students through CBSE, IGCSE, IB diplomas, because we have some content and we have some stuff that we have to get through. Direct instruction is really good for that. And probably, if you want to get, you know, Andy referred to schools being judged on attainment and outcomes in the UK, if you want to get better outcomes in terms of those standardised, formalised exams, then probably you can't afford to ditch your direct instruction. The personalised, the inclusive, more inclusive bit is how do I deliver that and do the stuff that I need to do each term, but also differentiate it out for the different abilities I've got in my class, my form, my year group, my school. And then the inquiry-based stuff, it's how much do I give them, because I know that that stuff is really good for them. I know that they develop great, the concepts develop if students are put in positions where the same activity, the same approach can allow a student who's got really high special needs and a student who is gifted to demonstrate what they are capable of and be creative from the same sort of task or stimulus.
Excuse me, Ken, we were already beyond time. Can you please wrap up in a few more minutes?
Absolutely. So the last picture really is a sort of a graphical representation of, you know, in effect, we are the organisers of a marathon. We have some students that are great athletes and are almost at the end, some that are only just starting, some that are really talented but have decided that they're not really fast and they're going to take a rest. Others that are injured or have got some sort of disability, some that are tired halfway, and somehow we've got to make them all finish at the same time. And that is really not very easy. So I am hoping, I'm doing the preparation and the legwork at the moment to embark on a PhD that looks into that very conundrum. Thank you.
Thank you, Ken.
Most welcome.
Yeah. Thank you very much. I would say the architecture itself tells a lot. I was quite fascinated by the architecture, by the emphasis on ecology and the approaches that you use. We use the approaches as well, project-based, inquiry-based, but we could see it in your school. I would love to be a student in your school.